Hey everybody, Anthony here, FSU Off-Road. Welcome back to another video. It's been a couple weeks, or a couple months rather. I'm doing a lot better. Thank you all for the comments, encouragement, motivation to keep going. But with that being said, it's time to get back at it and get this thing finished up. Okay, like I said, it's been a couple months here, and I have been in the garage messing around here and there when I can. Got a lot of things taken care of and a lot of things in the works to finish this thing up first and foremost. Also, I've been recording a little bit, but I've just been out of my element. I've just been out of the game with it, and it's just part of it. But with that being said, let's kind of do a recap on the things that we went through on the Jeep to get it going and some of the old footage that I have. Now, it's been a few weeks since I've been in front of the camera, so you have to pardon me. A little rusty, not that I was great at it before, but I have had a chance to come out here, kind of tinker in the garage, mess around, and you can see the culprit of the damage. Upon further inspection, you can see the mishap here. And just in a rush, I just neglected to bead roll the other side of the coupler here. And that causes a concern because I don't know if I missed any other ones, because there's like a lot. So we'll do that. We'll take care of this off camera. Not gonna bore you with that. What I wanna do is focus on this to-do list, get it all knocked out, and get Tinkerita here completely race ready. That way when we are ready to race, we won't have to do anything but do a race prep and go have some fun. In order to get this thing completely race ready, there's a couple things that we need to focus on my one to-do list that I've been working on. And that's a lot of interior work, AKA steering wheel, horn buttons, sirens. We gotta do the winch switches, install the winch. We also gotta wire up our GPSs as well as the radio and comms. I want to get all that stuff wired up. New day, new problems. But not with the Jeep, thankfully. As you can see, got all of our stuff nice and tidied up and buttoned up. Everything ran to the center here. All of our communication cords all tidied up, going to the back side over there. And also with that, I'm gonna leave the dash off. That way we can get everything wired up for our trans fan. And I'm gonna integrate it into our Holley system. That way we can have these trigger and inputs. The secondary harness to the Holley is going to trigger. This is our coolant fans. Then I'll have another trigger wire in here. This is the ground for the fans. That way we can override it with our system. Obviously, these are just lights. This is a spare. But I have another trigger wire over there that we have to change for the transmission fan, which is going to directly, you can't see it, but there's a trigger switch up there. And once it's gonna read to the Holley, that way we can put transmission display on our Holley dash there. Get all that figured out, so gotta work on that. Okay, so what we have to install is rollover valves for the return, the supply, and the vent. Now, the Jazz fuel cell itself already has a rollover valve for the vent, so we don't have to put an external valve or shutoff valve on there. But what I do have to install are these little shutoff valves for the supply and the return. Now, more than likely, you won't be turning these on and off on a regular basis, but for Ultra 4 regulations and tech inspection, we have them. All right, as you see, got the ignition on. If you listen closely, you can hear the pumps going. No leaks anywhere. So we should be good to go on our new install. So I'm gonna be able to put all this stuff back up and knock out something else. But yeah, glad that that's all done and taken care of. And also, let's see if the horn works. I don't even know. Nope, not yet. Partly because I don't have it plugged in yet. So yeah, I gotta address that as well. All right, so now that we're caught up, oh, you like my hat? Yeah, well, a buddy of mine is starting an apparel company and this is kind of his signature logo, kind of getting some ideas on some hats, and he reached out to me. And luckily, we're working on partnering together to get some FSU swag out to you guys as well. So stay tuned for that. Hopefully that'll be in the works in the next few months. One of the biggest things, you know, obviously the biggest setback that I had was coolant lines. So in order to prevent any kind of failures in the future, well, I can't say that 100%, but in order to prevent any kind of couplers of popping off, we're eliminating them all together and I'm converting everything to AN lines. What I did, I went ahead and just bought everything I needed to convert everything over to AN lines, AKA the radiator, chopped off the inlet and outlet, put in some weld bongs, and one of my buddies hooked me up with some TIG welding, and he also did the thermostat housing. I just went ahead and painted it, as well as the vent tubes. Got all the fittings that we need, so we'll be able to take care of that. And I went to an AN20. Some people run AN16, some people run AN20, just because of the long residency and the size of the diameter. I figured going AN20 will just give me that much more residency. It doesn't have the velocity to come for supply and return, as well as, you know, that extra size will be a little bit more fluid capacity. But I just wanted to
show you what we're going to be doing to eliminate that in the future. So
we'll have to take out all these old coolant lines and get rid of those. Obviously I'll be keeping them around. You never know what you'll need them for. As well as CBM offers a press-in style fitting, AN fitting for the top and or front of your water pump, depending on what you have. So we're gonna be working on that, working on a couple of things with the fuel lines. Once we get all that installed up front, we'll be working on the front end assembly or the rotating assembly. Got a new alternator, tensioner, and things like that to install, as well as the oil, change over the oil, get our T's plumbed in from the coolers in the back, fill the coolers, get all that situated. And we'll be pretty much done with our list here. Pretty excited about that. There was three big things that we needed to do, and those were the three big things that'll knock off the list. Holy cow, that was way easier than I was trying with this stupid pipe wrench. So if you guys are having to do this, just drill out the top, stick you a chain in it, stick a bolt through it, and pop that joker out. I think I pulled it like 4 or 5 times. Clean, came right on out. Instead of having to press it out or twist it out or anything like that. Who would have thought? Little hack for you. Back at it here in the garage. It's been a couple days. I've done some stuff, but nothing to be like, oh, got a lot done. But the one thing I did manage to knock out was the fuel. And
I did have the shutoffs in the middle, but I did move them to the side here. That way they'll be easily accessible from the outside. Instead of being there when this is up, you couldn't get to it.
So that was needed. At least I have shutoffs where they're approachable.
Once you guys check this out, got a 45 to a 45 after we got everything installed. Obviously this will fit right there with our vent. We'll just run this up. run it down, just do the same routing as. And then down here we have a 90 that comes off the weld end bung that we made off of our thermostat housing there, and it'll run down and we'll just do the same routing we did before up on the back side here. Keep it nice and tucked in. You can see there's a bracket where I had it before. We'll keep it close there, come up back through here and integrate into our new fittings. So let's knock this out real quick. Okay, first of all, these AN20 fittings, these big mama jumbas right here, they're not fun to work with. They are rough and you have to have really big tools. I don't, so I had to improvise. But using aluminum with the vise, I was able to tighten them down and get everything ran. I've measured and remeasured and measured again multiple times because the AN20 hose is really expensive. Like, I found it, the cheapest I found it was like $18 a foot. And yeah, it's expensive. So we don't want to mess that up. Just showing you guys, got everything nice and secure in here and it's not going anywhere. I decided on some zip ties in some areas, and in some areas I decided to use like hose clamps. Where it's doubled up, I used hose clamps with the breaker in between. There's four of those. And then where it's just singular, I zip tied it. And double zip tied it. Should be nice and secure. Everything's nice and tightened down back here. Runs down to the chassis. Cooling is done. I got the vent tube and all that stuff hooked back up. So coolant's done. Everything's done. Now I just gotta get some oil back in it and fire this thing up and start filling the coolant up. That way we can take this thing out tomorrow. Time's winding down, as you can see by the sun blinding me. Well, it's late. I got a bunch of stuff done on the Jeep. Finished everything up. Coolant getting filled up. Oil, skid plates, panels are going back on. I'm beat. And I'm done. I'm gonna get this thing loaded up in the morning, make sure everything is flowing, cooling right while we're loading it up. And that's gonna be pretty dramatic considering this is exactly what happened last time before we were loading up and we got hurt. But we're not gonna bring that mojo back. This thing is ready to go riding tomorrow. So we're gonna get it loaded up in the morning and we're gonna go riding. But that's gonna conclude the video. I hope you guys like what you saw. Make sure you subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks for hanging in there while we were injured. Got lots of videos coming. So stay tuned and we'll catch you on the next one.